sir. Those are helpful.
Probably everything I got for you. This.
It's this letter.
About ready?
It depends how much that we're going to pay.
I call a meeting to order Tuesday, December 10th, 2013, work session at 2 o'clock. Thank everyone for coming. If everyone would please stand and stand for the Pledge of Allegiance and the Invocation. Dear Lord, please bless everyone in attendance here today. Thank you for the great days of rain, but thank you for the sunshine that's out today. May everyone have a great Christmas, great New Year's. In your name, we thank you for everything. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. Adoption of the agenda. At this time, are there any changes to today's agenda?
I'd like to make a motion we postpone it for 12 months and have engineering bring us back an additional traffic study at that time. Not study, additional traffic sounds at that time.
Okay. Have a motion second to postpone out 27 for 12 months. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion fails, 3-2.
I'd like to make another motion.
Yes, sir.
I can make a motion number 47 on the agenda we table.
Motion second, table. All in favor, signify by any discussion?
That can be brought up at any time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Give notice.
We have a motion and second, table item 27. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries, 3-2. This table. Any other changes to the agenda?
Mr. Chairman,
yes, sir.
County Attorney's Office has two changes to the agenda.
Mm-hmm.
Item number 31.
Will we purchase future insurance for attached for a loss or something like that?
Yes, you would have excess protection on a per occurrence claim as well as aggregate stop loss. So your deductible right now is a large deductible. We would be moving that up a little bit, but the reward significantly outweighs the loss.
And so on the second page here, scenario A, for example, the red in parentheses bottom of $778,000 represents what?
Well, that number represents if you had no losses throughout the year compared to your current total cost of risk. Total cost of risk is your retained losses plus your out-of-pocket expenses for claims management as well as insurance.
And so that's what the savings would be?
Correct, but that's not going to be possible.
Right.
You're not going to have zero losses.
Right.
But we projected the box in the middle that shaded is a projected what the projected losses and expenses would be for the year.
Okay, so if I understand this right, then the very absolute minimum, not what the reason for the minimum is a savings of the 778, and the worst case that you can construct is a cost of
Yes, in a different scenario.
So it's the risk of whether those, where on the extreme of those two will fall.
Correct.
Sorry.
Will any of our stop loss insurance cover that massive loss?
It's barbaric if they do this to us. Sorry.
It would. It would actually, your stop loss is around $2 million. So this contemplates if the aggregate protection was breached.
I think that our loss experience has been really well in the past. I think that probably the benefits of moving to self-insured is just a couple of the more control that the county has and my department has in regards to claims, any third-party vendors such as legal, nurse case management, all of those kind of programs where right now when we pay a premium to ACCG, you know, once we pay that $325,000 deductible, it's their, I mean, our premium, it's their claim. So this gives the county more management of that, more options. There's some monies built in for loss control services, which in our industry, the more training and emphasis that we place on loss control, the greater the reward that we see on the claim side, which is really, you know, one of the biggest variables, is really trying to avoid, you know, any of those catastrophic claims. I think historically, we haven't breached in the 10 years we've been with ACCG, we haven't breached our $325,000 deductible, so our claims have remained below that level, which is very good for a county our size with the risk that we have. ACCG, as Scott said, has been, you know, great to work with, is really trying to avoid, you know, any of those catastrophic claims. I think historically, we haven't breached in the 10 years we've been with ACCG, we haven't breached our $325,000 deductible, so our claims have remained below that level, which is very good for a county our size with the risk that we have. ACCG, as Scott said, has been, you know, great to work with. I think the biggest thing with me is some of the claims management services that we've had through this past year was my biggest concern for us looking at other options.
And this, you don't feel like it increases our risk? Like, I mean, I know you never know when the big claim is going to come along. You can't plan for it.
No, you don't. And there's always going to be that. I mean, there's always going to be, you know, the risk of that happening. But I think, you know, with the county, we're currently self-insured on medical. But I think that's where it comes in. What is the risk appetite of the county? What is the risk appetite of the board? You know, Dave and I kind of looked at it. I mean, we feel comfortable with our reserves that we have now under workers' comp. You know, through all the actuarial studies that we've had, you know, we're beyond what they say we should have, you know, set aside for those claims.
We have our fund. It's a separate fund. It's a self-insured fund. And above even booking the liabilities, we've accumulated over $2 million in reserves. So if this worst-case scenario happened in a given year, it wouldn't impact the general fund. This fund, so we're well funded.
Do you find candidates our size going to self-insurance?
Yes. if we oversimplify the risk versus reward, the cost savings in our projected year is about $150,000. The additional risk that you have is $175,000 of retained amount. So your experience in the last 2 years, you've not had that $175,000 type of claim.
Do you find counties our size going to self-insurance?
Yes. if we oversimplify the risk versus reward, the cost savings in our projected year is about $150,000. The additional risk that you have is $175,000 of retained amount. So your experience in the last 2 years, you've not had that $175,000 type of claim.
Would that $175,000 go into a reserve to cover any claims, or does it go back to general fund?
And what you have to think about too is when you look at these claims, none of these claims are going to be paid in 1 year. I mean, even the value of the reserve of a claim is going to be paid over multiple years. So if you have one of those catastrophic losses, it's not all going to be paid within that 12 months. We would have the foresight to know, you know, how much we would be paying for that claim, you know, in multiple years.
Real savings would go back to the general fund and the other user departments.
I know you've worked real hard on this, so it's your recommendation we do this in the charity to save money.
I mean, you know, I'm comfortable either way, but I do feel like that we're in a position to move and, you know, and to challenge our program. I mean, with the board's support of an aggressive loss control program, and to be able to use the enhanced loss control services and the enhanced systems that moving to a new TPA would provide, I think with your support in allowing us to be, you know, build in a better safety culture and loss control program, I think it would benefit the county. I think it's been proven that there would be immediate savings.
And the Mayor Chair, answer the Chairman's previous question, I think I heard about other counties. There are seven counties similar to us, and the chief of which next door is Cherokee County itself on it. Some of the others are Floyd, Douglas, Fayette, Clayton, Houston, and Dalton, if I pronounce that correctly.
With the board's support of an aggressive loss control program, and to be able to use the enhanced loss control services and the enhanced systems that moving to a new TPA would provide, I think with your support in allowing us to be, you know, build in a better safety culture and loss control program, I think it would benefit the county. I think it's been proven that there would be immediate savings.
And the Mayor Chair, answer the Chairman's previous question, I think I heard about other counties. There are seven counties similar to us, and chief of which next door is Cherokee County and self-funded. Some of the others are Floyd, Douglas, Fayette, Clayton, Houston, and Dalby. Dalby, if I pronounce that correctly. Of course, the large ones around land, they're even bigger, but they're all self-funded. It's a thing, you get to a point where it makes more sense, and I concur with what.
And we've kind of reached that size for the population.
So. 200,000 mark it out.
Well, I don't know that it's about the size. I think words like robust and the study of probable safeguards and things like that added to the overall size is the hinging factor. It sounds like, based on third-party study, that it would not be unreasonable for us to go on a self-funded system.
And the advantage you have when you're self-funded and when you have a good program like we have with loss history is that what we pay in the market is our experience. So if we do have those catastrophic losses, I mean, we will pay for those, you know, in the excess insurance market. But when you're with a pool, you're always assessed how the pool's assessed. So if you're doing great, but the pool overall isn't performing, you're subject to all of those individuals in the pool.
That's your market.
So it's kind of to the point, do we feel comfortable enough with our program that we feel like it would be feasible to stand alone based on the financial security of the county and having the support of the county manager and the board? And I believe that we do.
Thank you, Chair. Any other questions?
Doug, you're good with it?
I am.
This is a time-sensitive item, too.
And Mr. Chairman, if I may, there's several items in order to, if you want to move towards self-funded, it's on the bottom of that memo, the recommendations. I believe Council would probably want to see all of these in separate motions. In order for us to move forward, there would be one that you would have to approve to move to a self-funded, and then you would have to approve that the application to the state Board of Workers' Compensation be completed with the authority for the chairman to sign. And then there would be items 3 and 4, which would be selecting the excess insurance carrier and the third-party administrator.
Sherry, let me say this.
Sure.
If we do it in separate motions, there is always, since we're talking about risk, a risk that one will get approved and another might not get approved.
How do you view the possibility of any
combination of these, with one being approved and none, or some other ratio of the others being not approved.
They're all needed.
Your question calls for left eyebrow relief.
I don't have a big problem with one motion. It is, we need those specific actions.
Can we do it as one motion?
One motion, but read all four items into the one motion?
You can do that.
Let's do it as long as it's clear that there are four items making up the motion.
Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the self-funded workers' compensation program as discussed and on the memo dated December 6, 2013.
How do you view the possibility of any combination of these, with one being approved and none, or some other ratio of the others being not approved?
That's a good point, Darren. They're all needed for
your
program.
Your question calls for left eyebrow relief.
I don't have a big problem with one motion. It is, we need those specific actions.
Can we do it
as a one motion?
One motion, but read all four items into the one motion?
You can do that. As long as it's clear that there are four items making up the motion.
Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the self-funded workers' compensation program as discussed and on the memo dated December 6, 2013.
Any other questions? We have a motion and a second for time sensitive item 14 for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 15. The award of construction bid C-13-55-5212, construction of Charleston Park.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman of the Board. This, we are asking to award this. This is a SPOST project. I'm sorry, it's not like this, SPOST 6 project. This is for some enhancements to the park. If you remember, part of the monies is coming from SPOST, and there's $52,000 that are from grant funding. It's $52,000, that's for the pedestrian bridge and the abutments and things that we can use for that. We would like to award the bid C-13-55-5212 to Phillips Brothers in the amount of $421,050.
Thank you. Any questions from the board? Do we hear a motion for this SPLOST 6 item? Any other questions? We have a motion and a second for time-sensitive item 14 for approval. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Carries 5-0. Item 15, the award of construction bid C-13-55-5212, construction of Charleston Park.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the board. This, we are asking to award this. This is a SPOST project. I'm sorry, I stopped right there. SPOST 6 project. This is for some enhancements to the park. If you remember, part of the monies is coming from SPOST, and then we have $52,000 that is from grant funding. It's $52,000. That's for the pedestrian bridge and the abutments and things that we can use for that. We would like to award the bid C-13-55-5212 to Phillips Brothers in the amount of $421,050. Thank you.
Questions from the board? Thank you, John. Jump right to it. We're going to take about a 10-minute break before we start on item 24. We'll reconvene at 3:55. Is that all right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Working harder to do that. Start small and go big.
I think
think everyone appreciates that because you focus in on it and that it doesn't wind up being a needle in the haystack. That sort of situation.
We try to help them out as much as we can.
And interrupt you for that.
But if I ask for that, then I'm going to get a big charge and start small and then get big. Seeming to accept, I go big and then.
I'm going to start back at 356 for my short break. Everybody pay attention, please. Okay, we're on to item 24, and we're going to talk about our road projects only.
They'll be looking at programming money for, which is 2018.
But at least they can think about programming that money based on what we may be doing forward and looking at what contributions we may be able to help with.
How long does an environmental study last, John? Do we have to do another one?
Once you get your environmental approved, then that, what that does is authorize you to begin right-of-way acquisition. Mm-hmm. Now the study, I'm not sure what the expiration is, but it's probably a year.
So if we funded it, if we didn't do anything within a year or two, we'd probably.
If you didn't start buying right-of-way, then you'd have to update your environmental. Once you start right-of-way acquisition, you're pretty much good to go. But you got to have those right-of-way funds programmed and in place to begin that process. Fully funded, and then they got to program the construction funds.
But with a bond, we can do any county-owned road with a bond. We can go ahead and start.
You can do any state road if you fund it 100%.
Yeah.
That's what T-Squash was going to be. And that way you could expedite those projects and build them without following all the federal guidelines, because it would be 100% local money, just like Squash is, just like a bond would be. So you have to follow state requirements and let them review the plans, but you don't have to follow the federal guidelines, federal processes, and then get the federal environmental approvals.
I think if we think that's a conflict, we terminate the contract.
Because I think one of the counties made up Judge Hall thing, and 369 you're interested in running straight through.
Counselor, can you answer that question?
Well, I think a little bit it depends. I mean, let's just cut right to the chase. Are we talking about, for instance,
sewer plants? Yeah, go
ahead. Well, I mean, there's a couple of ways to handle it.
I know what your intent is, non-lobbying you during the term of care.
Well, identifying that I am lobbying you.
Is this related to second motion?
Well, I'm not going to leave this meeting without being clear on which is the motion. I can lobby, but I've got to identify or not at all.
I just wanted an amendment that he would have to. My amendment was that he could not lobby us and lobby for another company to us.
That's what I understood you to be saying. Yes. What Commissioner Tam clarified with was something a little different. So I just want to make sure that's an actual amendment. Is there been a second, Mr. Chairman? I
think. Not yet. We're just trying to get that amendment straight.
Yes, sir.
So that's the actual amendment right now, that he will not lobby us somewhere.
That he can't be under contract with us and lobbying us to go with another vendor as College Creek or whatever.
We have an amendment to the motion. Do I have a second on the amendment?
I'll second that.
We call any other discussion? Vote on the amendment to the first motion. All in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Counselor, we got that down?
Yes, sir. I got it.
But back to the original motion.
I know what your intent is, non-lobbying you during the term of carrying out this.
Identifying that I am lobbying you.
I'm not going to leave this meeting without being clear on what, which is the motion. I can lobby, but I've got to identify or not at all.
I just wanted an amendment that he would have to. My amendment was that he could not lobby us and lobby for
That's what I understood you to be saying. Yes. What Commissioner Tam clarified with was something a little different. So I just want to make sure that's an actual amendment. Is there been a second, Mr. Chairman? I think
not yet. We're just trying to get the amendment straight.
Yes, sir.
So that's the actual amendment right now that he will not.
If he's
lobby us somewhere.
That he can't be under contract with us and lobbying us to go with another vendor as College Creek or whatever.
We have an amendment to the motion. Do I have a second on the amendment?
I'll second it.
Kyle, any other discussion? Vote on the amendment under the first motion. All in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Counselor, we got that down?
Yes, sir. I got it.
And back to the original motion.
Commissioner Tam, did you please take that motion?
I did. Cindy, did you get it?
I think so. I'll have to listen to the tape, but got it.
Basically, to direct the county attorney to bring back contracts similar to what we are currently operating with on time-sensitive
spaces. I understand with Commissioner Mills' amendment.
And it can be terminated any time.
Yes, sir.
Of course.
Commissioner Levent second, I think.
It was. We have a motion and a second for the language that Commissioner Tam presented. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries 3-2. Counselor, you got all that out?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Item 26.
Commissioner Tam, please take that motion.
Did Cindy, did you get it?
I think so. I'll have to listen to the tape. That's right. Got it.
Basically, to direct the county attorney to bring back contracts similar to what we are currently operating with on a time-sensitive
basis. I understand with Commissioner Mills' amendment.
And it can be terminated any time.
Yes, sir, of course.
Commissioner Levent second, I think.
It was. We have a motion and second for the language of Commissioner Pam presented. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries 3-2. Counselor, you got all that down?
Yep, yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Item 26.
Could I get clear on one thing? You mentioned having a transportation committee meeting, but on January 7th, the board's going to bring back recommendations first, right? So we'll have the meeting after that, maybe after we meet with GDOT.
We're going to have some one-on-one conversations to try to come up with this, hold together a meeting before January 7th.
A transportation committee meeting?
Yes, our local.
Well, but
and maybe with a consultant in the room to see.
But we don't have our list complete by then on time.
But we're going to bring, that's what Mr. Tam said, that we could then postpone another 2 weeks and get to refresh it and get more complete.
What about, could we meet the transportation committee people, meet with one-on-one and get ideas from other people to present at that meeting?
Long you advertise, Council. We have three there.
No, one-on-one.
In other words, can Ms. Mills sit down with Mr. Amos and say, okay, what's your wish list?
And one would you like, and then sit down with Brian and say,
what is your community?
Yeah, I would prefer we not do it that way, if you don't mind. I mean, why don't you just all attend, as long as it's advertised as a transportation committee meeting and a board meeting, you can just advertise them in tandem and all show up at that and discuss it.
Want you to let us know when the date for your transportation meeting is. You'll try to get some time, so let the rest of the three of us know.
If
okay.
Y'all all want to attend and advertise, then let us decide when you want
to
have it.
Yeah, we have to advertise. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes, sir.
Let's do it the first week. Todd's out of town. I'm kidding.
Okay, y'all decide. Y'all two get together and decide it. Let us know. And we will appropriately advertise that. Item 26.
Cashbury Road has been tabled temporarily. Item 28 has been postponed to January 27th. Item 29. January 7th. Got too many too. Discussion of Chapter 8 of the Unified Development Code.
Bob. Yes, sir. This, in a nutshell, is the issue of whether to ask property owners who are asking for rezoning, if they are not natural persons, to provide a list of all the people in their LLC or trustee or partnership or what have you at the beginning of the zoning application process. And I would like to have a bit of a discussion. There was a there was a modification that was discussed in the Planning and Zoning Board. I think it was just a two-sentence modification or one sentence. But even from it, I had some questions, Counselor, I'd like to ask. One is there a difference, or would there be a difference between whether it's a person, whether the people involved are in an LLP or a corporation or a trustee? I mean, I don't know how many different possible types, variants of entities there could be.
Yeah, I think it was drafted, I mean, with an expectation of just what our historical experience has been. I mean, there's nothing magical about it. I mean, it was just drafted with the idea of identifying principal members of entities other than real persons.
Than real persons.
Right.
So currently, I think it's my understanding that if it's a natural or a real person, they have to say, you know, I'm Joe Blow and I own a piece of property and I'd like to rezone.
Law treats a corporation as a person. So yeah, I mean, a real person simply identifies themselves.
That's right. But also, you know, my desire would be that we identify at least substantial, and I don't know how to define substantial in all cases, substantial list of the owners of the entities other than just natural persons when they apply for a zone.
Do you have any backup? For me to read, I mean, how do you want this worded?
Well, I don't necessarily want to vote on it today because I would like, Counselor, based on what you've heard me say here, do you believe that the document that was provided to the Planning and Zoning Board would cover what I've mentioned so far?
I think it would cover the overwhelming majority of situations that present themselves.
Now, I've also heard, however, that if we were to make an attempt to identify the natural persons, that the people involved in non-natural person entities, they would simply just go and get somebody to be their representative, and so it would be this property
agent.
Is now agent. Thank you. This property is now being asked to be rezoned by agent, whatever that group's name would be, and so we would then be in a position where all we potentially see an increase in property X is requested to be rezoned by agent Y, with no further insight into who the owners of the properties are. Do you feel that's true? And if so, is there a way to word it so that we still get the information that I'm looking for?
To the question of if it's true, I don't know if that would be done at all. To the extent you're asking, could it be done? I think yeah. I think that when the owner of the underlying property authorizes an agent to act on their behalf, I think they can identify that agent however they want to and whoever they want to. I will say that I question a little bit, you know, just going into the public participation process, I wonder how that would work, because you would at least suspect that the public participation process, the actual proposed, for instance, developer would have to be a integral part of public participation. So at that point, it seems like we would then know who the developer is. I think if that's the point you're getting at, is that we wouldn't know who the developer is.
But don't we in public participation, don't we realize who the developer is now when it goes to public participation?
We know who the individual is that is there on behalf of the company.
Yeah.
Is that now, as you're saying?
Well,
I mean, I'll yield a little bit to Tom on that and what his experience has been, but my understanding would be someone with some technical knowledge of the development that would actually be there providing the public participation.
But they don't have to be.
They don't have to be.
But
I think it's
they
important
are,
to make a distinction between the owner and the developer. The owner, this proposal would draw the information we're looking for or that potentially looking for on the owner.
Mm-hmm.
For the applicant, I don't see that quite as a clean a connection. Because with the applicant, I do think you have the potential to see an agent submitted for the applicant. And at the public participation meeting, no, there's no requirement. That agent could be the representative there at that meeting.
But don't normally most applications could be done by the owner of the land, since he technically hasn't sold the land yet. I mean, all you have to do,
could be, yes.
And then it just puts his name on it instead of the person developing it.
That's also true.
That's correct.
Yeah, and
we get property owner, their attorney, yeah, a third party, the realtor.
And then we don't know who's developing the property.
Help me understand, Jim, what it is that you're trying to accomplish. Are you, do you think that there is a, it's because we just have before us in these folders that we have to sign and attest and sign an affidavit that we have no interest in a property, that we are not participating or any of our family is making money off of it. So we are, that is covered by law. And then whoever puts in for an application, Tom, they have to disclose if they've given money to a campaign, correct?
That's correct.
And that's according to state law.
Yes.
So that's what, done now.
That's we done that, now. That's presently done.
Yes.
So what is it you're
is
looking
adequate?
For?
Is it not adequate, what's happening now?
I'm not sure it is. I mean, when I see, I'll admit I'm slightly now confused between whether I'm talking about the developers or the owner of the property, but I may be talking about both. You know, we've had some scandals in other counties recently, and they appear to be ongoing. We've also got, I think, some mistrust or suspicion about what happened with this baseball stadium, and a sudden flurry of LLC trading properties that built up to what finally was appropriated and that they're asking taxpayers for. And I don't see why it's such a big idea to know the actual individuals involved in who are requesting the zoning.
Well, we could lose that by having the owner do it, and then we don't have any idea who the developer is.
Right, and I said I may actually have some confusion on my part, whether I'm actually interested in knowing both or one or the other.
I mean, are we basing the zonings on who owns the property or basing on our zoning laws?
Well, I think it's on the zoning law. On the other hand, I don't know why the public, it's a public process, I don't know why they wouldn't be, you know, have an interest in knowing who all of the actual individuals are.
Well, I mean, are you worried? I mean, it's like, I mean, I think we have a state law that people that speak against zoning should come forward and say that I've given money to an individual too.
They're subject to the same disclosure requirements as supporters.
And we don't do that now.
We don't do what now?
Ask opponents to give their, how much they gave to some candidate.
We
allow them to speak freely.
Right.
We do ask them.
Well, I mean, they're legally required to.
But we don't. I mean, if they get up in the middle of a zoning meeting and they speak against the zoning, we haven't required them to furnish
any form or do anything.
They've got a form.
Well, whether we are taking proactive steps to require them to do that or not, I won't comment on that, but they're required to under state law.
Mm-hmm. But is that on our form, Tom, we fill out?
I don't know off the top of my head.
The other part, though, is that if a blanket agency comes and says we're doing this, it is not necessarily the case that I would know the members of that agency to know whether I have a conflict of interest or not.
Yeah, I can see. You know, I'm reminded of how Disney World was built. That Walt Disney bought a lot of land around the Orlando area, but didn't want people to know necessarily that he was buying it.
Yeah,
because
the price
of the land would have gone up,
but
if people would have realized he was assembling properties.
Yeah, and that doesn't, based on what you said, that's a non sequitur, because I'm not asking to find out who buys land.
You just want to know exactly who the applicant is, because you might vote differently.
That's it.
And you can't vote differently.
My concern is that of a openness for the public to see, and B, for my own knowledge, to know for a fact whether it's possible that I have a conflict of interest based on who the names of the people being.
But technically, we could drive the builder behind the scenes and let the owner come out to do it, and we would never know who the builder is until he bought the land at the very end. So right now,
I don't disagree. I mean, we could do a zoning, and the fact that we do the zoning, and then later on, another developer does the project. I don't
That's
believe
right.
that we've tied anything to the developer of the project for the zoning.
A lot of zonings are done before the land has changed hands.
Yeah.
You know, and if the zoning doesn't go through,
and
the sale doesn't go through.
If the zoning goes through,
a lot of
can still change hands.
And there's a lot of zonings, zoned properties, went into foreclosure, and got assumed by other people.
I agree. I just think that, you know, the public ought to know at least who the owners of the land are at the time that the zoning is being requested.
So I read somewhere that in Fairfax, Virginia, they do this. Do you have any idea what the other 158 counties in the state of Georgia do?
No, but I don't represent them.
No, but I did have staff look at all the adjoining municipalities of our county, and none do this because... I mean, I can't speak why they don't do it, but what concerns me, say we put this into, and this is hypothetical, but and you and I have already talked about this, but say that we get them to sign an affidavit, and it's a horrible zoning that we don't want to happen, really, and we vote it down, but it's a person's name on there that's already had, and say it's in your district, and that's already had issues with you. Have we given them a whole new ground because of who they are, that they can now say that we have shown bias and prejudice against them, when really it should have been voted down. But because we have this in place, we've given them an avenue to sue us that they didn't have before.
Yeah, but here's the thing. If they're represented by some sort of an agent, which they typically are here, that agent could declare the same thing about all zonings. They could write a preemptive letter tomorrow that says all five of us have a bias against agency or law firm or whatever, zoning firm X. Please don't vote on any of our zonings anymore because you're biased.
I think we're supposed to look at the facts.
Well, you're supposed to look at land use.
And the land
use. You're supposed
to look at that specific thing.
Well,
I have reached out to some attorneys, and I have asked, do they see that this, would they like to see us do this? Would it be advantageous to give another means of being able to bring lawsuits? And, of course, I mean, they've said yes, that they think that it would. Have said that. I also got one response that said, I think a credible argument can be made that requiring private corporations to disclose their members is a prohibited violation of the corporation's right of privacy. And it is not supported by a compelling government interest, and it's not the least restrictive measure necessary to accomplish that interest.
But that's one opinion.
It is one opinion.
And you know what opinions are like.
Yeah, but don't you think we have a pretty open system now? I mean,
was there a lawyer that wrote that opinion? So he's actually
there's a lawyer right
there. I have a paid.
Yeah, but there's a lawyer right there.
I'm going to ask him. But I've seen opinions from people that aren't lawyers that try to make a legal opinion, but this is actually from a lawyer.
It begs the question why the people in Virginia are so amenable to having lawsuits.
I'm all about what is it you're afraid of? What is it you're wanting to accomplish? What do you think's happening? I mean, do you think that all five of us commissioners are making money off sales, and is that what's bringing it up? I can assure you that I'm not, but I don't think anybody else is.
I think I was pretty clear that because of the background of what's going on
in Cobb County,
semi-locally,
we're not building a baseball stadium. Mm-hmm.
And this came up before that Cobb County thing came up.
Yeah,
I mean, that's an afterthought.
But it still argues the point, right? Regardless, if it comes up tomorrow, I might bring it up that it came up tomorrow, too. It still argues
what,
the point.
I don't know what point we're trying to get to. You
the
just
point
don't know
is openness is so that people in the community can know what's going on with the zoning.
So are you going to make a motion?
I mean, but then what if the owner just does it? Then we still don't know. Are the lawyer is his agent? We don't know anymore. Right now, it's pretty open.
I think the way it's being done right now, we have a pretty good idea without anybody saying. We pretty much know who's doing the deal.
We don't. Our county law is tougher than state. State only recommends you have a $250 threshold. Our county says you have to have a $100 threshold of gift given to report it. So we're tougher.
That's for entities that can be known, but you can't know who is in an entity if it's just an LLC.
May I ask a couple questions to Councilor?
Yes, sir.
I need to go back on a couple things that were asked just for some clarification. Donations for those for or against. So right now, if somebody
had given a donation to a commissioner, they have to list that on their application, correct?
Yes.
$100 or more. Mm-hmm. And those that gave donations to a commissioner that are against the zoning should by law
shall
by law give that information, but probably don't. For example, somebody comes to one of our meetings and absolutely has petitioned the commissioner to vote against a certain zoning. If that person gave to their campaign fund more than $100, should that person have made it known?
It's supposed to be 5 days before you speak against it too.
Right, it's disclosed.
So is that correct? They're supposed to disclose that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. 5 days before the talk.
If.
We don't enforce
so
that.
We can go back and look at any commissioner voted against the zoning, find out who also was against it, and see if they made a donation to that commissioner.
It's not.
And there might be a problem.
A commissioner's not going to be culpable.
No, it's the speaker.
But the speaker.
Speaker yes. is. Uh-huh.
Yes. Interesting.
You know?
All right, the next thing. Donations made to a commissioner, they're disclosed.
Yes.
But it doesn't stop the commissioner from voting on the item as long as, ethically, as long as they're not an owner or family does not have vested in financial interest in that property.
Right.
Or the deal in
the
any way.
The Ethics and Zoning Act.
Just because they took a donation doesn't cause a conflict of interest, does it?
That's correct.
Okay.
Not a campaign contribution.
Not a campaign contribution. That's what I mean.
Clearly anticipated.
Just a campaign contribution because it's all disclosed.
That's right. So long as the other requirements of the Ethics and Zoning Act are followed, last Commissioner Mills was talking about the personal financial interest in the zoning. But with respect to a campaign contribution, no, that's not a recusal. That's not a disqualifying event.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I know the few family members that are up here or have any property. I'm quite clear what they own. I'm very even more so clear what I own, so it's not hard for me to understand why I have a conflict.
We discussed this quite a bit. Jim, you got a motion?
I'd make a motion that we ask Counselor to provide, even if it's the same words as before, were discussed in planning, a modification to the UDC that would require applicants to disclose the ownership of a piece of property that's being considered for zoning. And list all the members of the entity if it's a non-natural person.
Do I understand that? No, go ahead.
I want to give a second for discussion, but I'm going to maybe draw it because I want you. So I'll give a second for discussion.
I think you've got to give a discussion.
Okay.
Give
now, a second. And I may withdraw that second because I would like for you to add.
It first.
No, I would like for you to add in there that anybody that's going to speak against it needs to fill out, that we require in our UDC, they fill out a form also if they have any conflicts and or they give the commissioner a donation. Because it's the same word, should work both ways.
Like a motion.
No, I'm saying it should work both ways. If we're being disclosure, we need to have disclosure both ways.
But isn't that already there? Didn't you say it's
already
well,
it's in state law, but it's not in our UDC. He's doing UDC changes.
Is it our UDC?
So we're going to have a public hearing, two rounds of public hearings to put this in.
I understand.
And vote for it.
Let me answer a question. Is that in our UDC that the other side also has to disclose?
We wouldn't. If it's in state law, we don't need it in the UDC to enforce it. And I'll tell you, I mean, honestly, we have those forms set up to be compliant with our requirements. I don't know them off the top of my head.
But they don't do it.
But we don't. I'll tell you, the larger pictures, we don't. In state law, we don't need it in UDC to enforce it.
Exactly.
Okay.
Discussion.
I just want to reiterate. I know that this board, all five of us, knows fully well the discussion we had. I went back and watched on a Sunday afternoon the Planning Commission meeting of October and the Planning Commission meeting in November. And our meeting where we brought up and voted unanimously 5-0 for Pete to write the letter, and that letter, and Tom, I just want to say this out loud for the record, the issue and the discussion that we had that day was primarily, and I know you were out of town, but you've watched the meeting, that was primarily the result of each of us have had things we have wanted done by the planning department. I myself, since January, since I got into office, I've been in particular wanting to add three residential categories that we haven't even gotten
to a discussion. Jim spoke up at that meeting and spoke out and said that he had been wanting to do an overlay and talked about the maps. Brian spoke up and said he had been wanting impact fee studies and something else, and all of us, we've never been in more full agreement about that we were tired of not being able to get issues to move forward. We understood, but we didn't know how any other body, especially one that was appointed, could be able to move issues forward any faster than we could, and we needed to understand the process. Now, I have been raked over the coals because I brought it up and I asked about a chain of command. I don't know any corporation, any business, anything that doesn't have a chain of command, including a board of commissioners and county government. But I want to make it clear that Pete's letter was not done as a something by Pete, that Pete just went out and decided, hey, I'm going to write a letter. That it was done wholeheartedly with the support of five board members, 5-0, and the letter was not a diversion tactic. It was written because we still, and yet we're now taking up more and more time to talk about an issue instead of the issue I wanted done in January.
Yeah, but we've also essentially starved Tom's department. I mean, we've put all kinds of stuff that makes it easier for the development. There are 13 items that I think got put on by how we can make things fun and easy for developers. We've added all kinds of stuff about alcohol ordinances and everything else to Tom's department.
It is.
We got him running around chasing stuff. He brings in about $900,000 in permits and stuff a year. He's hardly had anybody come and ask for any additional stuff. And the most we could think of is to say, you know what, we need a pecking order here because we're not getting stuff from Tom.
Motion to call the question. Second. You seconded it, right?
Motion to call.
I second it.
Call the vote. Is council, is that correct?
That's correct.
We have a motion to second right now. You're keeping your second. To send it to our attorney. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
Motion fails. 3-2.
No, forgive me. Okay, and that's my fault. The motion to call the question has to be voted on.
Oh, I'm sorry, Councilor.
And I thought that's what you were about to vote on, so forgive me.
We need to redo it.
Well, what you need to do is just announce that motion. I think everybody thought they were voting on the initiative by Commissioner Ball.
Okay, correct.
That's not what we're doing. Let the record reflect that. There was a motion second to call the question.
Call the question. All in favor of calling the question, please vote for saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 5-0. Now, Councilor.
Yes, sir. Now the vote on the pending motion.
Now we can vote on the pending motion. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Y'all opposed?
Aye.
Motion denied. 3-2. Item 30. Alcohol code prohibition on growler.
Alcohol code.
It's not alcohol.
Sleep of the devil.
We're never going to get ahead of growlers.
I can at least offer, and because I've been sort of at ground zero on this one. This pertains to the issue of growler tastings. You know, the Board of Commissioners modified its alcohol code to allow tastings on growlers, but you may recall that we require they to have them an establishment to have a closed off separate facility that we are identifying as a separate premise. And I know I don't have to tell you that members of the package business owners continue to be concerned and say that they want to be able to provide growler tastings but do not want to create a separate premises, that other jurisdictions are not doing that, and they are at a competitive disadvantage because that is being required in Forsyth County, and they want you to address it. My response back to you and those stakeholders has been, I continue to be very comfortable with my interpretation of state law. I continue to believe that state law says that you shall not drink on the same premise.
Item 32, approval of resolution and policy of the county regarding defense and settlement of civil actions against county employees and officers.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. First of all, let me say at the outset, this is a time-sensitive issue. It involves a fairly old litigation file called Knight versus Finley. It is a case arising out of the old sheriff's office that involved the domestic issue. I'm not going to get way into the weeds
of the exact facts, but just to say that the case has settled, and it's settled with our insurance carrier contributing $100,000 to the settlement.
Item 35, counsel, you want to take that one?
Mr. Chairman, I do, but I want to ask the board's indulgence with me for a second. 35, I need to go into executive session with you. That is land acquisition. I need to have a discussion with you in executive session, and then I need to come out, and you all may need to take some official action out in the open. But I was going to ask the board, would you all agree to go ahead and put item 36 next? Let's go ahead and get that knocked out.
So move. All in favor? Go ahead, counsel. Let's do that.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, item 36 that has just been moved up.
Counselor, is that
go ahead, please.
Need to go into executive session for the discussion on litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel?
Mr. Chairman, there is. Thank you.
We have a motion to recess the current work session. All in favor?
They did not.
No. Was it supposed to be time session?
It was requested.
I'm sorry.
Thank God. There's
nothing. Have a motion.
Yes.
Motion. Second.
Second.
Okay. All in favor, see if I'm saying aye. Let's go immediately into the executive session. We're going to go immediately into the executive session.
Listen, to everybody leaving the meeting, we will be coming out for one more action item, the last agenda item. So please just note that.
Chairman. Counselor, we stand reconvened at 7:07. We're going to get back to Pilgrim Square, item 35.
We do.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. We're giving to your youngest child.
It is.
Okay.
I need one.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay, we all have a counselor.
Mr. Chairman, this is the topic that we had discussed with respect to our land acquisition involving Pilgrim Square. You have been handed out a copy of a First Amendment to the acquisition agreement. You will also note on the record that there is a term that has been handwritten in with respect to testing for a certain compound called...
Well, I mean, I can open it.
Oh, you...
My key works. I can prop it open. I'll see if I find somebody in maintenance they can keep it open.
Oh, is it on a time lock?
I don't know.
After
I assume it is.
Thank
Are you videoing me?
Yes, John.
You're going to be famous.
Get a raise.
I need to get a contract keeping the doors open. As a consultant to keeping the doors open.
You better put on the hot seat a lot worse than that, hasn't it? Oh, it's okay.
Counselor, anything else?
No, sir. Thank you, Mr.
Can I motion to adjourn our work session this all night?
Already?
Somebody.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Mark it down. We've been here almost 7 hours.